gambling in the college game. And it catches Sherman White, it catches Kentucky, it catches schools on the East Coast and the West Coast. And so this book goes into a lot of detail beyond just simply K-State games. For Kansans, the key aspect or the most interesting aspect of the book is the KU-K-State rivalry. Prior to Gardner, there was no rivalry. Fog Allen was 39-13 against K-State before Gardner arrives. In the 25 games that Gardner will coach against KU, he'll win 12 of those. This rivalry really intensifies. It intensifies because of the great players that are playing at the two schools. I tell people, just go to Allen Fieldhouse, go to Bramlage Coliseum, check the rafters, check the plaques and the pictures on the wall, because this is some of the greatest players that ever played at these two schools. But the rivalry really ratchets up with the personal relationship between Jack Gardner and Fog Allen. They didn't get along. They had no problem at all telling every single newspaper in the state why. It's a very, very public feud. And you as a reader, you're ringside to this verbal boxing match between Jack Gardner and Fog Allen. So that's very, very interesting. This is the baby of the family. It came out in August of 2009, Club 50. Club 50 deals with high school boys basketball players in Kansas who scored 50 or more points in a single varsity game. It begins with 1921 and ends with the 2009 season. 72 boys from 62 towns. These amazing documented games. These are not fish stories. You know, I've traveled the state. This is like my 82nd or 83rd stop on this book since August of 2009. I traveled the state. Fish stories and basketball stories are a lot alike. Over the years, they get bigger and better and better. So the little fish that you caught when you were a kid should have been above the mantel place 40 years later. These are actually documented games. And so in the book, you follow these players through their basketball lives, how they learned the game in some of the humblest manners. The number three scorer in the history of the state is from Waverly, down by south of Ottawa. He learned to play the game as a little boy. Left hand is holding on to the railing of the crib. The right hand, he's throwing blocks into a sack that his grandmother held for him. And he's the third all-time leading scorer in the state. One of these boys out in western Kansas, he learned to play the game by shooting at a goal nailed to a telephone pole with no backboard. Some of these guys had the real luxury like me. I had my own private gym. It was the hayloft or the barn. And so you follow these guys, how they learned the game, what kind of teams they play on, and then you center in on these memorable 50-point-plus games that these guys had. Two misconceptions about the book is, first, you're just writing about big guys. They overwhelmed little guys. Why wouldn't they have big games? 72 boys in this book, 8 are over 6'5". The rest are my height. In college, I was listed at 6'3". Gravity has changed that, but these guys are still smaller. So it's not a book about giants. And the second misconception is, well, you're just writing about guys that had the three-point shot, which became a rule in Kansas high school basketball in 1988. Of the 72 guys, 12 had the shot, 11 used it sparingly, one did not. He lived off the line. He admits it freely. One of the great three-point shooters in the history of the state. He had a 60-point game at Osawatomie. So this book takes you through these basketball lives of these players. It's not the book people thought it would be. It's not a dry statistical book. It's not a book about fish stories, exaggerated claims. Not a book about tall guys overwhelming little guys. Not a book about guys who benefited from some rule change. Very simply, a book about high school boys basketball players who loved the game and couldn't get enough of it.